In 1966, on graduating from high school, I took a journey, a three-week photographic tour of the Soviet Union, organized by a Canadian travel agency and co-led by my uncle, Bernie Easterson. In the midst of the Cold War, we saw not only major European cities like Moscow and Leningrad, but traveled east into Asia, just a few hundred miles from the China border. We made the golden journey to Samarkand. It was a photographic tour, so of course I took pictures. Ektachrome slides, which, until this summer, have been sitting in a shoebox for 47 years. Almost all the slides you'll see in this video were taken by me, except a few, like this one, where I am the subject. These were taken by Uncle Bernie. Somehow, at age 17, I had the foresight to both number and label my slides, although, as I surmised going through the slides this summer, my labeling was probably not entirely accurate. While my shoebox contained several artifacts from the trip, such as receipts, a list of tour members, and these baggage claim checks, nowhere do I have a record of the precise itinerary. Based on my slide labels as well as these artifacts, however, I'm reasonably confident that the itinerary as I present it here is accurate. It's interesting, though, how memory plays tricks. Before reviewing the slides this summer, I would have sworn that we stopped in Minsk, but clearly I would have been wrong. There's nothing in my slides or other documents to suggest that I was ever in Minsk. As best as I can reconstruct it, our journey had us entering the USSR in Moscow, then on to Leningrad, Yalta on the Crimean Peninsula, Pyatigorsk and Tbilisi in the Caucasus in Georgia, and finally Bukhara and Samarkand in Uzbekistan. I thought that we had stopped in Tashkent as well, but I have no pictures of it. A bit of research revealed that there had been a major earthquake in Tashkent just 3 months before our trip, so perhaps while Tashkent was in our original itinerary, we ended up only passing through the airport on our way back from Samarkand to Moscow. Like any proper international travel of the time, our journey began in New York City, and despite my many visits to New York and my having lived there for nearly 8 years in my 40s, I believe that my only visit to the top of the Empire State Building was the day before our flight to Europe. It would be another 5 years before the World Trade Center would dominate the view to the south, so the more interesting view was to the north, toward the Chrysler Building and the Pan Am Building. We met most of the tour group, our fellow travelers if you will, at dinner in New York City the night before our departure, although this particular picture was taken later in the journey. There were 17 of us, led by Uncle Bernie and co-leader Pelle Svensson. I was the youngest, but there were three college students, Jim and Jeremy Johnson from Flint, Michigan, who were traveling with their parents, and a senior at Yale who was traveling with his uncle, who turned out not to be his uncle, actually. We flew overnight to Amsterdam, where I recall an interesting tour, a jet-lagged day, and a rice taffle dinner, but apparently I took no pictures. The next morning, we flew to Moscow. Here we're visiting Red Square. It puzzles me why I have no pictures of certain landmarks I distinctly remember, like Lenin's tomb, but perhaps it was on the long list of things that we were not allowed to photograph in the Soviet Union. All foreign visitors traveled to the USSR was arranged through InTourist, the state-run tourist agency. On arriving in Moscow, we met Lisa, the InTourist guide who would accompany our group throughout the tour. In her early 30s and fluent in English, her charge was to keep an eye on us while steadily feeding us with propaganda. Regardless, she was personable, knowledgeable, of good humor, and hence well-liked by the group. Her husband Anatol joined us for our few days in Yalta where I took this picture. Yes, we were allowed to photograph the Kremlin, although from a reasonable distance. To be fair, we were not constantly harangued with propaganda. For the most part, the focus was properly on history and culture. At some point, Uncle Bernie tactfully suggested to Lisa that we had heard enough of the Soviet take on Vietnam, and we heard little more about it. I was especially interested, though, in the claim that the Soviet Union would have the highest standard of living in the world by 1980. Given obvious shortages of goods of all kinds and a pervasive sense of dreariness, it just obviously wasn't going to happen. Getting ready to start college in the fall, I found our brief stop at the main building of Moscow State University especially interesting, and I was sorry that we could not go inside. Built after World War II, containing thousands of rooms and miles of corridors, it was the tallest building in Europe until 1990. Our tour included time for leisure, like this visit to what was then the world's largest open-air swimming pool, where we were sequestered in a special area for foreign tourists. The pool was built in 1958 on the abandoned foundation of the Palace of Soviets, which had replaced the demolished Cathedral of Christ the Savior. The cathedral was rebuilt on this site in 1995. Our journey, of course, was not without the occasional glitch. Taxicab drivers were required to have knowledge not just of geography, but of automotive mechanics as well, quite understandable in light of the apparent quality of the cars. So a flat tire in the midst of Moscow traffic was just a minor inconvenience, which the driver handled with dispatch. A potentially more troublesome misadventure occurred when Uncle Bernie led three of us off the Moscow subway one stop too early, not noticing that nobody else from the group was getting off the train. I would note here that the Moscow subway system was definitely and explicitly on the do not take a picture of list, yet here we all are, me, Edith Weber, and the good-natured group grump, Oscar Hurwitz. I don't need to tell you, of course, who is behind the camera. And so we next flew to Leningrad, now known, of course, as St. Petersburg, where surely we spent the better part of a day touring the Hermitage, one of the world's oldest and largest museums, founded by Catherine the Great in 1764. While I do remember actually being there, try as I might, I cannot remember anything I actually saw there. I did not have much interest in or knowledge of art at that age. Well, at least after my visit, I would be able to think beyond Andrew Jackson when hearing of the Hermitage. The notation on my slide reads Leningrad War Memorial, and of course, Russia is a country full of war memorials. While my internet research this summer found several war memorials in St. Petersburg, I haven't found this one. Perhaps it has undergone some sort of transformation in the post-Soviet era. As you see, gold is hard to photograph on a sunny day, and while the Soviets may have claimed disdain for Tsarist excess and extravagance, my recollection of Peterhof, Peter the Great's summer residence, as one of the most beautiful, opulent places I've ever visited is vivid. It was meant to rival Versailles, and having now visited both, I would call it most successful in doing so. From Leningrad, we flew to Simferopol on the Crimean Peninsula, and then went 30 miles by bus to Yalta on the Crimean Sea. We surely visited Livadia Palace, site of the 1945 conference between Roosevelt, Churchill, and Stalin, but I have no pictures of it. Nonetheless, it is Yalta that I remember best of our stops. It was the most modern Western place we visited, and its beach, while very crowded, was beautiful. Probably the main reason I remember Yalta so well was our visit to the Artek, the Young Pioneers Camp, where I got to interact, under watchful eyes of course, with young people not only from the USSR, but from throughout the communist world. Founded in 1925, the camp was open year-round and hosted up to 27,000 youth from socialist countries every year. For the most part, youth camps are youth camps, and activities like this concert were typical. But a visit to the Artek was considered a reward for well-behaved socialist youth, and the lucky young pioneer might get to meet communist heroes who visited the Artek, like Castro, Ho Chi Minh, or Yuri Gagarin. The Artek continues to host youth from around the world today. Uncle Bernie equipped me with a Polaroid Swinger camera. Introduced the previous year, the Swinger brought instant photography to the masses, instant then meaning a minute or so from picture to print, and was one of the best-selling cameras ever. Russian children had never seen such a thing, although interestingly, a few admitted to having heard of it. So I became something of a celebrity around children and older youth, drawing crowds from which Uncle Bernie would sometimes have to extricate me. Next, we flew to Mineralia Vodi, another resort town named for its mineral baths, for a brief visit to nearby Pyatigorsk on the northern edge of the Caucasus Mountains. There we toured this vast collective farm, another of my more vibrant memories from the trip. Lisa especially seemed to enjoy the outdoors, and looking back, I realized that the three-week tour through a variety of destinations with a group of affluent, affable, educated Americans and Canadians must have been a plum assignment for an in-tourist guide. Perhaps, though, this idea merely reflects my own leanings as an Orthodox American. The collective farm must have been vast, and it looks like we got an extensive tour. Here we got to see Russian cowboys, who looked, of course, pretty much like American cowboys. Our hosts were proud to show us their agricultural products. What they neglected to tell us about, of course, were the shortages and limited choices which we had heard about and which became obvious in our later visits to marketplaces. Here we were treated to a horse show. While I hadn't thought about it at the time, I presume, and certainly hope, that these handsome horses were meant for riding and perhaps for work. Like a kibbutz, the collective farm was a self-contained community. Here we see the school. Of course, a kibbutz was a locally governed, freely chosen enterprise, while the collective farm was centrally governed and largely imposed on its participants. The difference, both in ideology and outcome, was clear to us, knowing that by the mid-1960s, the USSR was importing millions of tons of grain from the USA and Canada annually. Part of the reason for stopping at Pyatigorsk was to stage us for a 200-mile bus trip through the Caucasus to Tbilisi. While the condition of the bus did not inspire great confidence, and the road was narrow and winding with steep drop-offs, the scenery was spectacular. These were the first mountains that I had seen outside of the Blue Ridge. It was a leisurely ride, taking the entire day, affording plenty of time to enjoy the surroundings. Our bus trip ended in the Georgian city of Tbilisi, located on the southeastern edge of Europe. Tbilisi played a prominent role in east-west trade routes for 1,500 years. Here, the city, with its mix of medieval, classical, and Soviet architecture, is seen from the mountainside, connected to the city by funicular. As we traveled eastward, we saw more and more traditional enclosed and open-air markets. The markets revealed little variety in consumer products, and it was obvious that shortages of goods were endemic throughout the Soviet Union. We tend to think of the Soviet Union as having been a godless state, but they didn't seem to have gotten the memo in Georgia, where the influence of the Orthodox Church was clearly visible. Further, Tbilisi was said to have a long-standing tradition of religious tolerance, with Orthodox churches, a synagogue, and a mosque in close proximity to one another in the city's old town. Originally the site of a pagan temple, tradition has it that a cross was erected here in the 4th century, reportedly able to work miracles. The site drew pilgrims from throughout the Caucasus, and this building, the Great Church of Javari, is thought to have been built around the turn of the 7th century. Now, finally, we were off to Asia, specifically Uzbekistan, where we would first visit Bukhara and then finally Samarkand. Lisa stayed with us, of course, but in Bukhara and Samarkand, we were joined by a local guide as well, whose name I believe was Tamar. Her garb suggested that we were getting away from the worst of Soviet drab, and judging from the picture, as well as my very vague memory, she was several months pregnant. Looking back, I'm sorry that my high school ancient history class hadn't better engaged me. There I was, in the shadows of Genghis Khan and Tamerlane, in the heart of an empire which briefly ruled much of the known world, with so little appreciation of where I was. Nonetheless, the allure of the East, the fascination with antiquity, was inescapable, and over the years, as I've become more interested in the Middle Ages, I find it thrilling to have actually been there. 160 feet tall, the Great Minaret is the highest structure in Bukhara. Built in 1127, it has survived earthquakes and bombings. In addition to its religious uses, it was a convenient place for executions, carried out merely by dropping prisoners to their death. Clearly, you didn't want to get on the bad side of ancient rulers. Curiously, this slide, stored among my Bukhara slides, was labeled Observatory, but I knew the famous observatory to be in Samarkand, not Bukhara. A bit of internet research reveals that this building was known as the Ark, the fortress of a line of emirs notoriously known for torturing and killing prisoners. And finally, Samarkand. Here, the tomb of Timur, Tarmashirin Khan, more generally known as Tamerlane. With dreams of restoring the Mongol Empire of Genghis Khan, he conquered West, South, and Central Asia in the late 14th century. During his lifetime, he was the most powerful ruler in the Muslim world, and while patronizing religion and education as a means of legitimizing his conquests, his armies were feared throughout Asia, Africa, and Europe. The Samarkand Observatory was built in the 1420s by Ulugh Beg, grandson of Tamerlane. The largest observatory in Central Asia, it produced charts describing 1,018 stars, illustrated by this reproduction which I saw at the historical site. One of the most fascinating classes I took at Yale was on the history of mathematics from antiquity to the Middle Ages when, I learned, much scientific and mathematical knowledge, largely forgotten in the West, was maintained by Islamic and Jewish scholars in the East. When we briefly discussed the Samarkand Observatory in class, imagine my delight in actually having been there. This is Registrand Square, the historic center of the city. We were visiting sites dating to the 14th and 15th centuries, so it's hardly surprising that they were in less than pristine condition. More recent pictures that I've seen on the internet, however, suggest that the Uzbek government has undertaken extensive restoration, which is at best, perhaps, a mixed blessing. In my research this summer, I came across a 1997 travel article from the Washington Post entitled "Sacking Samarkand Again." Scathingly critical of the restoration, it decries the transformation of historical Samarkand into a theme park for the sake of tourism. I can see the point. I walked on cobblestones which had been trod upon for hundreds of years, and carried with me a sense of antiquity which I can't imagine getting in a restoration. From Samarkand, we flew to Tashkent for the connection to Moscow, and then on to Amsterdam to end our tour. Uncle Bernie and I did not return immediately home, but instead picked up a new Volkswagen in Wolfsburg, with which we spent an additional 2 weeks in Germany and France before flying to London and then home. An adventure in itself, I'll save those pictures for perhaps another project. I was ready to come home, and one of my fondest memories is coming out of customs at Dulles Airport and recognizing just about everyone. My family had prepared a lavish homecoming for one very jet-lagged, soon-to-be freshman at Yale, home from a magical mystery tour with memories which, as you've seen, would not just last a lifetime, but would always color my view of the world.